I'd like to welcome everyone this morning and in roll call where Janet Wai is going to be absent for these next 2 days. She's off trying to fix the state budget. John Bacon had some problems this morning that will delay him. He'll be here later in the morning or early this afternoon. Otherwise, everyone else is here except our attorney, who is...
So let's move on.
We're ready. We're here. I'll go ahead and read the mission statement. The mission of the Kansas State Board of Education is to prepare students for lifelong success through rigorous, quality academic instruction, career training, and character development according to each student's gifts and talents. Please join me in a brief moment of silence. Thank you very much. If you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance and stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Yeah, they kind of got us on that one. I'd like to call your attention to a change in the agenda. It's just a minor change on item number 12 on the acting on Professional Practices Commission recommendations. Item 2, Sarah Corson. Her case will not be part of the packet today. Do we need to have a motion on that change or just an announcement? Right here on the professional practices. We're withdrawing her name. Okay. That will not take a motion. It's just a notification of a change. That will not be part of their report. We need a motion for the for approval of the minutes from the May State Board meeting. Do I have one?
Yes.
By Sally Cobble, seconded by Dina Horst. All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. Those opposed, same sign. 8-0. Oh, I'm sorry. No, we didn't.
I so move.
Okay. And noting the change. Sally Cobble, seconded by Dina Horst. All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. Those opposed, same sign. Carries 8-0. Commissioner's report. Brad? And this is Brad's last meeting with us as the interim commissioner, and we'll talk more about that later, but... You're on.
Well, thank you. This isn't just because it's timely. It's my last one. But I just wanted to share with you as a reminder of why I was not here at the last board meeting. Because I was doing this. So I just wanted to share with you a little bit about the experience that I had the honor of representing. There were 8 commissioners from across the United States that traveled to China to meet with their provincial That's the equivalent of their commissioner. So I just wanted to give you an update on that experience. A little bit of the difference is in the United States, we have states. In China, they have provinces. So eight of our commissioners, we met in Shanghai, which is on the, I would say, the right-hand coast of the map, which would be the eastern coast. But those, all of those provinces, they had the equivalent of their province commissioners met with our delegation from the United States. And it was quite the flight getting there. I didn't realize. I flew out of Detroit, and we actually flew north and went over the top of the globe to China. And it was headwinds, and they were running out of fuel, so we actually had to stop in Beijing to get more fuel. But we finally made it there, and from when I left my house to when I went to bed, it was 38 hours. And a lot of movies on the flight. So, but anyway, we were in Shanghai. Just to kind of put it in perspective, and I don't think I was prepared for this, it's estimated 1.3 billion residents in China. We have about 319 million in the United States. And one out of every five people in this world are Chinese. They're geographically the fourth largest country behind Russia, Canada, and the U.S. They have about 199 million students, elementary and secondary, compared to just about 50 million in the United States. And to even bring it a little closer to home, our largest school district, Wichita, has 51,000 students. Shanghai has 5.7 million students. So just it's just that culture of trying to provide educational services to that large a population was different. They don't do assessments in grades 3 through 8, but at 8th grade, they'll take an assessment, and based on performance on that, it's where they go in high school. Whether they go a vocational track, whether they go an academic track, even academically, they base them on levels of what they expect performance to be. And then they even break them down. Are they on a math track? Are they on a English language arts track? And once you're decided where you're going to go, you can always move down, but you can't move up on the track. And just for fun, the last one, toilet paper was invented in China in the 1300s, but it was intended for emperors. Put that in for free. One of the main things that we wanted to discuss, and we spent quite a bit of time on, was around professional development, how we make it more meaningful. Just kind of bolding some things. They are big in to their teachers doing a lot of research. And that's actually how they move up the career ladder. And I'll share a little bit of that with you as well, all around their professional learning. The education systems, they really want to promote the 21st century skills and deeper learning. There was a lot of dialogue back and forth about how we're trying to approach that in the United States. I would say that when it comes to 21st century skills, we're probably further ahead in that those deeper cognitive in a lot of other areas when you talk about 21st century skills, those soft skills. I'll visit a little more about that. Trying to ensure that effective professional learning takes place in every school. One of their biggest concerns is the difference between Shanghai, for example, and Hong Kong. When we talk rule in the United States or even in Kansas, they have rule that is unknown to us, or there's no roads going into it. They have to fly everything in. I mean, so how do they replicate what they can do in a larger city to maybe some place where it's a three-hour plane flight to get it. And actually, the commissioner from Alaska was there, and he probably got it better than we did, because even in Alaska, they have rule similar to some areas in China where there's no roads there. So how do they ensure that in, so there's a lot of discussion on what does rural mean. promising uses of technology for professional learning, and even some really good conversations about the relationship between professional development and teacher evaluations. The other thing that we spend a great deal of time about is assessments. And it's not surprising, they're asking some of the same questions we are. How do we move from a paper pencil bubbled test to really an assessment system that can measure those problem solving, those critical thinking skills? There was a lot of presentations about what some of the assessments that are being developed in the United States. Technology-wise, I was in several different classrooms, and the only technology I saw, and I'll show you a couple pictures here, the teacher was using some technology, but they are very apprehensive in the use of technology at the student level. They know they need to get there, but they just haven't, you know, the one-to-one laptops, iPads, all of that. They are still very traditional in, for example, calculators. They're allowed, but very discouraged. And when you ask them why, they say, why do they need a calculator if they can do it themselves? So they know that they need to explore the uses of technology. Are we over-testing our students? Same questions that we've been asking. How useful are current assessments for informing instruction versus accountability? Two totally different things. The balance between local, state, and national testing. And then again, the role of student assessments in evaluating teachers. A lot of good discussion. We could spend a lot of time. I could share with you some of the more details, but just so you have an idea of what the conversations were. These are very limited photos. These just happened to be the ones that I was lucky enough to text back to the office while I was there. I have probably 200 photos, but someone left their phone at the airport in Shanghai with all the photos and videos, and I'm still rolling the dice that I'll ever get my phone back. But this was a very modern business skyline. This is in Shanghai. This is the one that was outside of my hotel window, so that's why it, I think I was on the 15th floor and they hadn't cleaned the window yet, but a very modern skyline. It's really interesting, if you look at the highway, all of their highways are elevated, and underneath them are their business streets, and it was, the traffic was just, I'm glad I was in a bus the whole time. And I don't know how the bus drivers do it. This was at 5 in the morning when I took this picture. And the traffic was just starting, but 2 hours later, it was bumper to bumper. This is another view. When you think just the city of Shanghai, there's 24 million people living in that city. And this picture doesn't do it justice. But you can imagine, I took this picture out of the bus window and I was taking it to my right. And if you could pan from right all the way to left, that's what you would see and as far deep as you could see. And these are hotels or apartments. It's just as far as you could see these kind of buildings because of just 24 million people in one city. I had some videos where I kind of panned it, but again, odds of me getting my camera back or my phone back. This is one I took out of the window. I had much better pictures of just the rows, but the most popular form of transportation is still bikes, small automotive. But anyway, it's I had some pictures where there was like maybe 600 scooters and bikes all parked along. It's a lot more cars now than there used to be, but it's still the most popular mode. This is a high school math class, and you'll notice that there is an overhead projector. What's over there on the right is a smart board. So the teachers were using the technology, but the students, in a day and a half of touring middle school and high schools, I saw one calculator. So, but anyway, some of their very early reform efforts is they're really looking hard and more at how do we value the arts. Sports. One of the schools we went to was a sports academy. And it was the equivalent of what we call, I would say, physical education. There was time built into the day for the kids to get out and get active. We met with a group of middle schoolers, and I asked them, what do you like to do on weekends? And they all laughed, and they said, the one girl said, can you repeat that? And I said, yeah, what do you like to do? Very fluent in English, by the way. And they said, yeah, you know, could you repeat it again? Third time, I finally said, all right, what's going on? And one of the kids says, Kansas John Wayne. They were laughing at my voice. They just wanted me to keep repeating it. But when they finally answered the question, they said, we study. That's it. They said, we study. Evenings, weekends. So they know that they really need to start looking at character development, individualized instruction. They're really interested in how can we measure non-academic skills, because it's all the test is more important to the student than it is to the system, because the test is the kid's ticket to somewhere, and it's less about accountability. It's about where the kid is going to end up. But well, they take the eighth grade, and then they may take some other assessments. In high school, they didn't visit much about it, but testing there is more of a ticket for the student. Only in the past year, they've been really getting serious about career and tech ed, career education, and they know that they're going to have to do more around individualized instruction and aligning to an individual student's interest. Some things I learned just about the teachers and the professional learning. New teachers have to use the lessons plans of experienced teachers until they can demonstrate. It typically takes 3 to 4 years for them to be able to demonstrate that they can create their own lesson plans. Their teachers advance to higher levels based on their level of mentoring, research, and study. So an entry level, or they call it a low level, a new teacher has about 180 hours every 5 years that they have to do around mentoring and research and study. The highest level, they have somewhere around 560 hours every 5 years that they've got to devote to research. And it's an honor for them to get to that highest level. One thing that's different, their teachers typically only teach 3, maybe 4 classes. They spend the rest of the day mentoring, evaluating classrooms. Just about every classroom we went into, there were seats back here, and there were always teachers sitting there observing, evaluating. And once a week, all the teachers come together, and they sit around a big square, and they spend about an hour and a half, 2 hours discussing what they learned. Very low stakes. They try to keep administration out of it so that it doesn't, you know, drive conversation. And we were able to sit in and watch one of their sessions just about what they learned, what they observed. They were very candid with each other. We think you could have done this approach differently, but that's once a week. So we thought that was a very interesting approach to professional learning on that. Their average calendar is about 220 school contact days a year, I'd say in Kansas we range somewhere around 175 teacher-student contact days. But around assessment, it appears we're all looking for ways to measure skills other than just academic. You know, our new assessments will get a lot deeper into measuring those cognitive, but looking at how do you measure some of those other 21st century skills. And then, you know, the difference between assessing to inform instruction versus in an accountability model, should it play a smaller role? And how do you measure those deeper learning and critical thinking skills? Lastly, this was the president of Shanghai University. I thought this was just a great quote, which I think kind of captures it all, that if in China, like I said, it was such, when you think we have millions, they have over a billion, and they know that, you know, if you're not educated, you're going to be a burden. But if you are, you're going to be a resource. So that's basically just kind of share with you some of the experience. It was a great experience. Good to have the opportunity. I'm going to stay out of those types of restaurants for a while. I've been loading up on cheeseburgers and pizzas ever since I got back. But other than that, it was a great experience. So. That's all I had. Don't take them off. Oh. I can give you a copy of this if you want.
Any questions or comments for Brad? Brad, sounds like a wonderful trip.
It was.
And who participated in the trip with you?
It was staff from Council of Chief State School Officers. There was also... the commissioner from Wyoming, Alaska, Tennessee, Oklahoma. I have to call them for my head, but it was a pretty good group, delegation.
And how long were you
Stephanie there? Hirsch, from the president of Learning Forward, she led a lot of the discussion around the professional learning, so it was a good group.
And how long were you there?
I left my house at 3:00 Sunday morning, and got to bed at 2:00 Friday morning. So it was, took a while to get there, but we spent all day Tuesday touring buildings, Wednesday and Thursday, something like that. It was kind of a blur, but it was 3 days of either touring classrooms or meeting with their providence.
And primarily you were in Shanghai?
Yes, it was all in Shanghai.
Okay.
Yes.
So. Carolyn Campbell.
Good morning, thank you. Do they identify the children that are low income, or do they have like free and reduced lunches? How do they take care of the children that maybe need assistance and after school?
They do identify them, but I think from what I gathered from it, I don't know what their funding system was, other than they provided public education, I believe, for every kid. But I don't know if they base their funding off of need or off of it was interesting. Every school we went to was gated. There was security, and you had to, and I don't know. It was one of the cleanest. It was very clean. They just had, I guess, the World Games or something there not too long ago in Shanghai, and there was always people walking around cleaning, but it was very hospitable. But as far as how they allocate resources, we didn't get into that.
Okay, so my next thing you said about the schools being gated, is that for security? What did you see anything about?
I We didn't get the appearance that they were trying to, that there was a security issue. They just wanted to make sure that the people coming into the school had a reason to be in there, I think. But never at any time did we ever think that there was, it was interesting, they had appointed a college student for every person. And the one that was appointed to me actually went to KU. So they tried to make sure, she said, yeah, you think this is a culture shock being in Shanghai with all these people. Imagine when I went to Lawrence. I was like, where are all the people? And it was a culture shock to her. But I had asked her, I said, you know, I don't see a lot of law enforcement, or I don't, she says, no, we just really not a need for it. So it's just a different culture.
Sounds like a wonderful trip. I hope we can get a copy of that PowerPoint. That'd be great. Anything else in your to report?
That's it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can we start this now? Is that open forum? We're going to go ahead and start the Citizens Open Forum. I now declare the Citizens Open Forum of Kansas State Board of Education meeting open at 10:25 a.m. The State Board provides this opportunity for citizens to share views about topics of interest or issues currently being considered by the State Board. The State Board asks that speakers identify themselves by name and the name of the group they represent, if applicable. State Board also asks that each speaker focus their remarks on issues or topics. Personal attacks will not be tolerated. Each speaker shall be limited to 3 minutes. Any board questions will be for clarification only. Our first speaker is Rick Pappas, followed by Tom Brungard.
Good morning. My name is Rick Pappas, and I am representing the Kansas Association for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance, or KFERD. I was here in January of 2014 talking about the importance of recess, and another KFERD member, Bo Bragg, came here in December of last year, and at that time he mentioned that there was a recess survey sent out to Kansas physical education teachers. And I'm here to share the results of the survey, and you're being handed a summary of a pamphlet we put out. This was in collaboration between KFERD and Healthy Kansas Schools through funding of the Kansas Health Foundation. It was sent to 951 schools, and we had a 51% response rate. One of the questions that was asked was, what is the total time allocated for daily recess at your school? And it was in categories, 0 to 10 minutes, 11 to 15 minutes, 16 to 20 minutes, 21 to 25 minutes, and more than 25 minutes. And as you can see, the majority had it 20 minutes or less. But to break it down for elementary, 0 to 10 minutes was 1% of schools. 11 to 15 minutes was 29%. 16 to 20 minutes was 33%. 20 to 25 minutes was 14%. And more than 25 minutes daily recess was 23%. For pre-K or preschool, 38% were 11 to 15 minutes, and 7% were under 10 minutes, or 10 minutes or less. And in perspective, to keep this in perspective, our National Physical Education Association recommends at least one period of 20 minutes recess daily. They're not talking about 10 or 15 minutes recess twice a day. That does not count toward the recommendation. It's one period. And we're approaching almost a third of the schools or elementary schools that did not have 20 minutes of recess. Then we had another question on the survey. How many Steve. There were 14 schools, preschool or pre-K, that did not have any recess. 6 elementary schools we found that did not have any recess. Of the elementary, 30% had it once a day, 61% had it twice, and 7% had it 3 times or more. In pre-K, there were 50% that just had it once. And again, the ones that had it twice, we need to just keep in consideration that not all of them were 20 minutes. On the back, we also have some recommendations from the American Academy of Pediatrics. And one of the things, too, was a third of the schools said there was less than 75% of physical activity time. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Tom Brungardt, followed by Daniel Clausen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I am Tom Brungardt. I'm a retired teacher, taught for 31 years. I now serve on the Gary County USD 475 Board of Education. And from 1992 to 2002, I served on two groups for this board. I served on the Regulations Committee and the Professional Standards Board. And we were the people who had the honor of changing the system by which people get to be called themselves teachers. Prior to the adoption of the regulations, which took place after I left the board, Professional Standards Board, teachers and administrators were called certified. You may remember that. Today they are licensed, although we still sometimes use the word certified. When we started the process of changing the regulations, we received a tutorial on the difference between licensure and certification. Licensure is granted by a government agency. Certification is granted by a non-government agency, indicating an advanced course of study. Think CPA, think National Board of Professional Teaching Standards. The other thing we learned, that there's a difference between licensing process and the employment process, and that under no circumstances should those ever be combined. For example, just because a school district thinks the teacher is a bad fit for their students does not mean that the teacher should be barred from employment in another district by having the license pulled. As I understand the proposal put forward by the Innovative School Districts that's coming before this body, they want to combine the licensing and employment function, which, as I mentioned earlier, was drilled into my head, that's not something you do. As a local Board of Education member, I don't want the functions combined. I don't want that or think I need that responsibility. Even though there's a shortage of doctors, no one is suggesting that the community health center clinic be able to license people and call them doctors. It would be very helpful if we could do that, because I also serve on one of those boards, the Kansas Community Health Board I serve on, and we have trouble finding doctors, and it would be great if we could simply designate people as doctors. We can, and we don't want to. As I mentioned at the top, I spent a third of my career working on teacher licensure. I'm asking that you do not move ahead with this proposal from the Innovative School Districts to allow them to certify people as teachers. Please do not combine the licensing and employment functions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Daniel Clausen, followed by Christy Levings, I believe it is.
Good morning. My name is Daniel Clausen, and I teach fourth grade at Rossville Grade School. I received a Bachelor's of Arts in Elementary Education from Bethel College in 2011 and a Master's of Science in Instructional Technology from Fort Hays State University in 2014. Throughout all these years as a student, I had many skilled professors work with me on the content knowledge that I would need to successfully teach in an elementary school. Many of these professors were also teachers or administrators in the public school system. And without exception, they all put equal emphasis on pedagogy and classroom management along with content knowledge. These teachers knew, I know, that teaching is about much more than knowing the content. In my classroom, just as in every classroom across the state, every student has very different needs. Explaining a concept to them the way that makes sense to me might yield 30, 40% comprehension, and that's being very generous. Were it not for my professors and their intentional focus on how to teach, how to diversify instruction, I would have been completely unprepared for this challenge. Now, I don't mean to challenge or discredit the professionalism of anyone who would like to teach. However, there are currently alternative paths for teacher licensure, and from my experience, these paths work. I know many qualified and excellent teachers who entered the profession through these transition to teaching programs. Please allow these programs to do what they were designed to do. Please do not deprofessionalize my career, my passion, my life. I strongly urge you to keep teacher licensure requirements in place for all Kansas schools for the sake of all Kansas students. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Steve Roberts has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If a retired physician or semi-retired physician filled a need at a local high school to teach, say, advanced biology and did a good job, would you advise us to maintain the rules or the regulations that say no matter how good a job that doctor does as an instructor, that doctor needs to go attend classes at a school of education in order to have that license to teach?
Yes.
We disagree. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Christy Levings. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. Followed by Erica Huggard.
Good morning. I'm Christy Levings. I'm here as the Vice Chair of the National Board of Professional Teaching Standards. I'm a longtime Kansas teacher, been licensed in this state for 40 years as a teacher and 20 years as a building administrator. Having been a teacher leader and talked about professional development in a great number of ways, including serving for this board on the Certification Review Committee for 5 years, 2 years as the chair of that committee. As you may know, that there are five core propositions to National Board certification. And what we have learned now that we have nearly 150,000 nationally board certified teachers across the state is there is a continuum that teachers have to develop their skills that begins with a rigorous pre-service program that brings about research, brings about best practices, brings about the ability to understand what is to teach, and that progresses through to become an accomplished teacher. In those five core propositions, one is about subject matter, and subject matter is important. And Brad, I had the opportunity 2 years ago to sit with the Minister of Education for China. That's a pretty big job he has, and to talk with him about National Board certification. And in the year 2020, they will hope to have moved where every teacher in that country has an initial license, and then they want to create 100,000 nationally board certified teachers a year for 10 years. That's 1 million nationally board certified teachers in China. Because they have begun to recognize that content knowledge alone is not enough. And that's why the other four propositions of national board certification have to do with understanding how students learn, understanding how you monitor student learning and you manage it, understanding that there is a systemic process that learners have, that you need to understand each learner in order to get the information into a way that works for them, and to become members of a learning community where information is shared. To go back to the question of a retired doctor, a retired doctor might know a lot about biology or physiology. However, that doesn't mean that they can teach. It doesn't mean that they understand what we know in those other four propositions, where you must understand the variations of students and the variations of how students obtain material, and that you need to know what it is to make it available to the learner. I urge you to not look at processes that take away the need for folks to understand how it is to teach. Understanding content is only one part, and that has certainly been done by the research of National Board Certification and in working with teachers all across the country. I would also tell you that I know from the time I worked for this board on Certification Council that we have good processes in place. There's a visiting scholar, there's an alternative license, processing, all those things are in place. You have the tools you need, and innovation does not require that you make it less. Innovation should only be involved in making it more. And to have better quality professionals means holding up standards and saying, how do we innovate and maintain the quality? So I urge you not to look at that as a process. And I also urge you to look at how we can create more nationally board certified teachers in the state of Kansas. We need processes that not only give people rigorous beginnings, but bring them through their career. Thank you very much.
Question, Mr. Chair.
Dina Horstis.
Thank you.
Good morning, Dan. Hi. How are you, Kristi?
I'm wonderful, thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
My question has to do with the learning process of the areas that you identified. Do you feel that they must have that totally up front? Or is it possible to learn it like on the job training, much as doctors do with a mentor beside them, working with them, et cetera?
Well, I think two things. First of all, your doctor example ends there when you say somebody who's in a clinical practice and is being mentored or interned through the process, because you've already assured that they have basics of clinical practice in the education program that they did. So that one sort of falls down when you do that.
The clinical, it's done, at least in Salina, it's done with mentors.
And there are a lot of practices that happen during that piece, but that gets into internships and student teaching with the other. The second piece that I would say to you is, if you look across the United States at programs of alt licensing, there are excellent examples and there are pitiful examples. And in excellence examples, there are people who are being used for content and gaining the ability to know to teach. You know, a Nobel Prize winner in the area of physics can do great things, but couldn't teach anybody what they know. Those examples exist everywhere. So, but there are really good ways to bring someone in or to use that visiting scholar piece to pair them up with somebody who has the skills in teaching and uses them as the resource that they are. But that doesn't change the teacher of record nor licensing. And I also agree that you need to look at licensing and advanced certification in very different ways.
Well, perhaps you and I need to visit a little later because I don't want to take time, the visiting scholar idea versus an individual who has the same qualifications going through a program that's been established. What's the difference? So think about an answer for me. When
you're ready,
later.
I'm ready.
Okay, thank you.
Steve Roberts.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We have 8 words on the wall behind me. Our students come first in every board decision. So could you tell me how it benefits the children if someone is hired to teach who does a very good job and relates to children, connects with them, has natural gifts of communication, and knows content, and perhaps has trained in some other fashion to connect with children? How does it help children to deny that person an opportunity to practice that love and that talent because of stultifying work rules? Please explain this to me.
Well, I would tell you that when I started on the Certification Council, we had a slogan too. Would you put that person in the classroom with your child or your grandchild? And it was always a number one piece as we looked at anyone who applied for alternative licensing or came through the certification process. If students come first in every board decision, then that means that you must have the most qualified person in that classroom. Love for kids, that's a great thing, and certainly a very important component. Content knowledge, that's a good thing, certainly a very important component. Having proven that they have the ability to instruct, you're missing in the scenario that you described. And I would say to you, you need to look at, if our students come first, the package must be complete.
Sorry, you're so wrong.
Carolyn Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Good morning, Carolyn.
Good morning, Christy. I think it's very inappropriate, Mr. Roberts, what you have done to the two Citizens Open Forum people that have come, and because you do not agree with their stand that you have done this, we should never attack, and that's how, if I were standing there, I would feel that you're challenging, and so I just think that it's very inappropriate what you have done.
Your apology is accepted. And again, I would be happy to instruct you with what I have learned in 40 years in the profession so you can see what you're missing.
If I may, just one quick follow-up, Mr. Chair.
This is a point of clarification.
It is.
I don't want a restatement of the issue.
No.
Go ahead.
There are people who refute what you have just alleged by their experience. And to that, I think we do need a further dialogue.
You can certainly do that later. We seem to be in a wheel. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank
appreciate you. I would want to make sure we don't lose this, but Nationally Board Certified is a wonderful program.
Thank you.
It is outstanding. It's it just makes a difference in every school, every classroom, and every school.
And we see nationally board certified teachers doing amazing things across the country and great innovation.
Truly. I've seen them in my schools. They're great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Erica Huggard. I hope I'm saying that right. And Megan Menely is next.
Good morning. My name is Erica Huggard, and I teach in Kansas, and I'm a KNEA member. I do not support the Coalition of Innovative Schools proposal for teaching license waiver. Last year, my building found itself needing a physical science teacher in August. The person we hired did not have a teaching license and was hired under the STEM alternative license route. We were relieved and pleased to find a candidate that at least had content knowledge, thinking that this would be a better option than a sub without content knowledge. We realized we were very lucky to find someone interested in teaching and that naturally enjoyed kids. We started off very positive about our situation. Our department vowed to make every effort to make sure our new colleague, a non-licensed teacher, would have all necessary resources available. Even with all our effort, we soon began to understand why it is so difficult to make a teacher out of someone with no education background. Needless to say, a few months went by, and we were beyond frustrated for several reasons. First, we did not see a commitment to the profession in our new hire that our teacher preparation programs emphasize. Our entire department spends countless hours preparing and collaborating before school, after school, and during our breaks. And when we train student teachers, they model our commitment. But this was not something that we saw in our non-licensed teacher. It is hard for someone coming from a profession that operates from 9 to 5 to understand this. Secondly, a desire to learn and self-reflect was another area of concern. In order to grow and improve, it takes a healthy level of self-awareness and self-reflection. Teacher education programs do an amazing job modeling self-reflection throughout the program. Without self-reflection, it is difficult to grow in the profession and strengthen our instruction to improve student learning. In addition, practicing high standards was also a grave concern. High standards are important for student success. Instead, we observed low student expectations and a teach-to-the-test attitude. This was due to lack of proper preparation and training. Our non-licensed teacher did not know how to challenge students and lacked an understanding of how to use data to improve teaching practices and maintain high standards. This is not the right approach and ultimately hurts student learning. In addition, we observed an unwillingness to put work in to be prepared for the content being taught. Having the content knowledge is one thing. Knowing how to explain that knowledge to a diverse group of students is another matter. It was a frustrating year, to say the least. Although the teaching profession is incredibly rewarding, many people do not understand that teaching is not a job, it is a lifestyle. I do not support the Coalition of Innovative Schools' proposal for teaching license waiver. It deprofessionalizes the teaching profession and deprives students of the best learning experiences they deserve. Thank you for the opportunity to share my concerns.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Megan Menely. Is that, did I do that right?
Menely.
I'm getting there. Thank you. Followed by Nora Kelting.
Good morning. My name is Megan Menely, and I teach all levels of German at Abilene High School. Today, I am here as president of the Kansas World Language Association, which represents all teachers of all world languages in the state of Kansas. As a high school teacher of 15 years, I can tell you that your efforts and leadership are making a difference. We're reaching more young people at the high school level than ever, helping them explore their passions and preparing them for careers, many of which haven't even been thought of yet. World languages have always been a part of the discussion for college-bound students, but in the 21st century, knowledge of another language will not only be important for students headed to college, but will have benefits for every single Kansas student. We want all students who come out of our public schools to have global literacy and citizenship skills, and world language is a key piece. That's not getting the consideration that we feel it needs. As this world shrinks, we can no longer assume that it's okay to send every graduate out into the world without knowledge of a world language. To learn a language opens their eyes to a bigger worldview, allows them to see someone else's point of view, and builds problem-solving skills. And we've got to give them these tools. We can no longer assume that knowing English is enough, and we're doing our students a disservice to allow ourselves to graduate them without the experience of learning another language. I recently heard it put this way. Today's monolingualism will be tomorrow's illiteracy. In other words, if they only know English, they will not be prepared to be successful. The KSWLA is asking the Board of Education to look into three things in order to encourage world languages as part of a 21st century education. We've been studying what other states are doing. As always, there are many ideas, but the three that we bring today have been successful in other states and are research supported. I will introduce each briefly, and my colleagues will follow with additional information. First, we ask that Kansas adopt a seal of biliteracy to be placed on the diplomas of high school graduates who graduate with a minimum proficiency in a world language to recognize their efforts and aid in the transition to post-secondary education and the workplace. Secondly, there has been much emphasis placed on career and tech ed and college and career readiness. All career pathways benefit from the knowledge of a world language, and we are asking for it to be included as an integral part of these programs. Finally, we would like for the board to consider the addition of a world language requirement for high school graduates to expose all students to global literacy and citizenship. These are necessary steps to ensure that Kansas continues to move forward and not be left behind. I ask you to consider bringing world language to the table as you continue to discuss how best to educate our Kansas students for the 21st century and beyond. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today.
We have a clarifying question. Kathy Bush.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for your information. Mm-hmm. Could you, to our board assistant here, send those three recommendations? I'd just like to have them in writing.
Sure. I could give you my notes here.
Okay. That'd be great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Nora Kelting, followed by Stephanie French.
Hi, I'm Nora Kelting, a veteran teacher of French, 32 years, 15 in Wichita schools and now 14 in Newton schools. I come representing French teachers across the state. And I'm going to speak to the third piece, which is a one-year recommendation for all students in Kansas public schools to have at least 1 year of study. We all know, pardon me, we all know that speaking another language helps us to get jobs, makes us more marketable, more competitive in the job market, makes us stand out among applicants. And did you know that 4 out of 5 jobs that are being created have to do with foreign trade these days? I didn't know that. There are also bonuses for people who speak another language fluently, an opportunity to earn a better living. There are opportunities for jobs in so many fields, art, music, dance, film, fashion, cuisine, television, philosophy, science, business, and in translating video games and working for Google. Languages are everywhere, and we need them so badly. There are also benefits to one's brain. Studying other languages helps us defend off Alzheimer's and dementia. It improves our attention spans, our memory, and our listening skills. We also are more rational in our second language than we are in our first. I guess you have to think harder. So we're better at decision-making because of those experiences. Speaking another language also changes our perspective. It eliminates certain biases, reduces prejudice, and helps us to appreciate diversity. Our students of world language also have higher scores on their ACT, SAT, and later on the GRE tests. One thing that at least a year of world language study can do for you is to help you understand English better and to understand other cultures. We can do that in 1 year to a certain extent. Of course, we want much more than that, but 1 year would be a step in the right direction. I'd like to close with a quote, and that is that every child should study at least 1 year of a world language, because world language is part of a basic education, and to educate means to lead out of confinement and narrowness and darkness. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Stephanie French, followed by Jane Bodecker Johnson.
Good morning. Morning. My name is Stephanie French. I am a Spanish teacher in the Olathe School District. I've been working there for 14 years. I am here representing the Kansas Association of Teachers of Spanish and Portuguese. I've been president for 2 years. I am here to introduce to you the idea of the seal of biliteracy for our Kansas graduating seniors. The idea of the seal is so that our students can achieve a functional level of proficiency in the English language and one or more additional languages. The purpose of the seal is to elevate the importance of international languages, support our English language learners in the state, provide universities and employers with graduates who are career and college ready, and who support a multilingual society. The seal of biliteracy will become a part of the student's high school transcript and or diploma. All students are eligible for the seal of biliteracy, and there are standardized tests that are available to determine the level of proficiency for each student. The seal of biliteracy is supported by many national organizations, such as the American Council on Teaching Foreign Languages, the National Association of Bilingual Educators, TESOL, which is the International Association of Educational Professionals, Researchers, and Students, and the National Council of State Supervisors of Languages. We are asking that you please consider and approve a recommendation to continue our push for our students to become part of the 21st century. Our global society has knocked on our doors many years ago, and we need to make sure that our students are ready to be part of this globalization. Thank you.
I have a couple of clarifying questions. Sure. Zara Cobble?
No. I hope I can answer them. We're still in the investigation stage.
So from my understanding of what you've said, there is already a seal developed.
Yes, there are about 7 states who have adopted a seal of biliteracy already, and we have been researching these states' seals.
Okay, and the seal means they've had 1 year, or does the seal mean they are proficient in speaking and reading?
The seal would state that they've had many years of international language / English language learning classes, and that they, the level of proficiency being functional means that they are proficient in reading, writing, listening, and speaking. As if you were to pick a student up, pluck them in another country, and they can function on their own.
Kathy Bush.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Part of my question you answered with Sally. I would assume for Spanish-speaking or French-speaking or students who come to the United States speaking another language, and they, of course, you answered it, because typically those students are, they can speak. Sometimes they can't read their native language, so they would have to be able to do that. But so I assume it's also eligible for those students who English is their second language once they become proficient in English, that seal of
bilingual literacy. We respect any student who comes to our schools speaking another language, and we want them to be proud of that language and use that language, but their goal then for the biliteracy seal would be to gain that functional proficiency in their second language, which would be English.
Mm-hmm. Plus making sure they have it in the reading or writing.
In all forms of communication, yes.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Jim Porter.
Thank you. This may be a Brad question, but would there be any prohibition for an individual school district to go ahead and do the seal if individual school districts wanted to do that? I'm not discounting what you said. I just think that, you know, that if in my school district, if we wanted to do that and support that idea, can we do that?
I wouldn't know. I'm not familiar with it enough to know if you could do it individually as a school or if it's a state.
It could be school by school, district by district. It's not necessarily just a state. We need the state to support us, but that doesn't mean that every single school district in the state has to have a seal of biliteracy. Without the state backing, I do not believe we can do that yet. I have not looked at that. I'm sorry. Okay.
Steve Roberts.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That was essentially my question. I would frame it this way. Of the seven states that have a seal of biliteracy, are they all state seals? Is the one I'm looking at here, California?
Yes, okay. They're all state seals.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our final speaker today is Jane Bodecker Johnson. Did I say that correctly?
You did. Very well.
Thank you very much.
Very well. My name is Jane Bodecker Johnson. I'm here as a member of the and former president of the Kansas World Language Association. I want to thank you for allowing me to speak before you today. I've been a teacher in the USD 440 Halstead-Bentley School District for 31 years. Most of that time I have taught Spanish. As a 3A school, we have been at the forefront of CTE and have 14 established pathways in our school. Almost all of our teachers are involved in one way or another with one or more of the pathways. However, when they have meetings about the pathways, there's definitely two departments that are not represented: world languages and music. Well, I'm here to talk to you about why I think world languages should be included in those pathways. I see a lot of positive things coming from CTE, but it is troubling to me why many of the pathways, for example, if we would look at the travel and tourism, why a world language isn't included in that. You know, how can a student finish this pathway and yet not have an understanding of the language and culture of another country or other countries if they're going into a field of tourism or travel. Nor do students in the building construction pathway have to have know anything about the languages of their fellow workers or maybe their future employees. At Pittsburgh State University, they recognize this by requiring students who are in their construction management class to take a Spanish class. Whatever career path a student chooses, language skills are going to boost their career prospects. In 2013, CNN deemed bilingualism as the hottest job skill. Additionally, it also boosts their pay. Employees pay 5 to 20% more to employers, employers pay 5 to 20% more to employees who are able to communicate in another language. I personally have had students who have gotten jobs at, very entry-level jobs just because they've had 2 years of foreign language, and that gave them a job above other applicants. And as a former professor of mine once said, speaking another language gives one the keys to the kingdom. And I think we're shortchanging our students by not having that in there. So thank you very much.
We have a clarifying question from Sally Cobble.
Thank you. You said that in your schools you have pathways. Mm-hmm. Are you, is there a path, it shows my ignorance here, is there a pathway that foreign language is in?
No, none.
Okay.
Absolutely none. Even of the ones we don't have in our school.
Okay. I represent the board on career and technical ed, and we have a meeting on Thursday. Thank you.
I appreciate your attention to that.
Thank you very much. The State Board Citizen Open Forum is closed at 11:05. We would like to thank our speakers for sharing their views with the board. The State Board will determine if any issues should be addressed as an agenda item at a future meeting. Our next agenda item is an assessment update. Dr. Smith? We're having a 5-minute break. We'll come back at 11:12. Okay. Dr. Scott. We are eagerly awaiting your report on assessments.
That's very good to hear. Thank you. Chair McNeese, we have a couple of things today. You have both handouts there at your seat. One is an assessment update. The other is, and Marianne Perry from CETE will be going through that. I will be doing essentially nothing today. And Beth Foltz will be going through the second PowerPoint, which is some survey results. And I think we talked about that at the last presentation. So Dr. Perry from CETE will, her presentation today is sort of divided into three parts. And as soon as she's finished texting, we had a bit of an issue today that we're trying to problem solve. So I just made a suggestion. I think that's what we're working on. So anyway, I'm trying to kill time here. So with that, Marianne Perry.
Dr. Perry, welcome.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you again. It's been a couple months. We've been pretty busy in the couple of months. I wanted to give you an update. What I want to do is just recap this assessment year. I don't think I've seen you since we started, and I've been terrified about saying anything positive for fear we'd jinx us. But now I can give you the positive update on where we are with our assessment year, what we're going to be doing this summer, and then what our schools, our districts can expect to see this fall in score reports. No cyber attacks in 2015. So we really didn't have any...
Can I clarify that? No cyber attacks that got through?
No cyber attacks that got through. Good point. Okay. Good point. We are very lucky. I don't know if you've watched the news with the other states, but there are quite a number of states that have had issues. And we've had issues across the country, not just at the state level or with vendors, but we've had issues where districts themselves were attacked by a DDoS
And so the state was testing fine, but one district would get shut down. That happened in a couple places. I was actually in Anchorage doing a site visit during their testing window and watched as a cyber attack tried to hit them and watched their firewall stop it. So actually, you can actually watch it graphically. And so Alaska and Kansas, we did good this year. So nothing major. We had just minor problems, a couple local problems we got resolved, a couple little things that are on our side. An item didn't work as it should. For example, it says drag X to the appropriate place on the number line, but X wouldn't move no matter what you did to it. X got tossed in the trash can when that happened. So we realistically, at the time, we can fix it immediately. We can get it fixed so that every kid who sees it after that can see the item as intended. But because even one student saw it and it didn't work, we have to throw the item out in terms of scoring. So we had a few of those that we were able to resolve within the first week. One of our concerns is that because we were pilot testing the performance tests in both ELA and math, that would our testing window be long enough? Would this be so much extra work that we would run out of time? And actually, it seems like we had plenty of time because we were down to just a couple hundred kids testing that last week of our testing window. So we would be monitoring it, and there are very few kids testing. So we clearly had a good amount of time. And we are very busy with data analysis right now. So the first piece of data I want to give you is about testing time. Tests took a lot less time than I expected. I don't know if you recall, but I came here sometime and said that I expected the ELA and math combined could take up to about 6 hours. A lot less than that. I'll give you that data in a minute. But it turned out everything, math, ELA, history, government, social studies, science, and performance task field testing, on average, took the kids 5 hours to do all of that testing. So it went very smoothly, and kids took less time than we expected on this. The MDPT, which is our writing task, took about 50 minutes total to read and write a response to it. A little longer in the early grades than in the later grades, but on average, about 50 minutes. Math performance task, a lot shorter than we expected, only took about 20 minutes on average. This is the one that has like about 5 parts to it, and it works together in a scenario, and the last bit usually has the child give a justification or communicate their reasoning or show their work, something like that. But the kids did well on that. And the history, government, social studies, remember, they're going to combine their results with the MDPT, but the part that stands alone for history, government, social studies was about a 30-minute test. So here's some data. And what this is this is the number, this is the time it took, and you read this as the first cell on your top left-hand side of the screen, read that as 1 hour, 48 minutes, 17 seconds. We're precise at CET. But what this is the computer time stamps you when you click on the thing that says, I'm ready to take third grade math. As soon as you've already logged in at this point, you've already heard some introductory directions, you click on that, and then you get directions specific to what you're about to do. And then you take the test, and then you do your review of the test, and then you hit, I'm ready to save and exit, and yes, I'm sure, exit. And then the time stamp stops. So this includes reading the test-specific instructions and reviewing and exiting. On average, you can see on the total, and this is math and ELA combined, kids were spending about a little over 3 hours taking both the ELA and the math portions together. This is all the computer-based parts, taking those together. When we also wanted to look at the maximum time. Maximum time is a little funny because, again, the way that our KITE system calculates time is if a student gets reactivated, so they take a test, get reactivated, or something goes down with the internet and they get kicked off, the time continues to run. So it's until the very end of save and exiting. So we have kids that looks like it took them 3 days to finish the test. Well, we know no child sat in front of a computer for 3 days. So we threw out all that weird-looking data. And now what we're left with is the maximum amount of time that it took kids to take the ELA and the math combined. So in third grade, the maximum time is just over 7 hours, and 10th grade, just over 4 hours. We haven't looked at the results close enough to know if the reason the difference between third and 10th grade is so great is because the third grade really is a harder test, if it's because the kids just take longer with the computer, and keep in mind this is not the writing, so this has nothing to do with keyboarding skills, or if 10th graders just don't care as much and blow through it pretty quickly. We don't know what's going on there, but once we do some data analysis, we should have a better idea.
Performance test, that pilot went very well. Third graders did fine with typing. The initial data analysis indicates a good distribution of scores. This was something I've been worried about. We rolled out these kinds of writing tasks in a state I used to work in probably 4 years ago, and we had on a 0 to 4 scale, we had 0 4s and I think about a dozen 3s. So I was very nervous about, is this going to be one of those tasks that is so hard because of the idea that you're writing to make a claim and then use supporting evidence from the text to support your claim, how good are our students on it? We've got some 4s, we've got some 3s, so it's pretty good.
Mr. Willett has a question.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Back to your time elapsed slide there. Is that in multiple settings? Is that in one setting?
Nope, multiple settings.
Okay.
All right. So most kids took, this is divided, each ELA and math are each divided into 4 parts. Yeah. So the proctor, the teacher, the principal, whoever could decide how many parts you take in a day. But overall, the kids had to take 8 parts. We expected the first part to take about 50 minutes, and then the second, third, and fourth to each take about 25 minutes. Okay. So as I said, we expected closer to 5 to 6 hours as our, okay, our time.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Your next slide. Third graders did fine. What mm-hmm. does fine mean?
Fine means I don't have the data to give you really good details yet, so I was trying to generalize. Fine means that we did our study where we went into, 17 school districts, I believe, and we observed a lot of third grade classrooms to try and see, do we see the kids having problems? And then we also had focus groups with the teachers and you know about human subject review boards, none of us are allowed to go in and actually talk to students, but we had questions that we would give to the teachers and say, if you're comfortable about asking your kids some questions, we'd love to hear the responses. And many teachers did that for us, so we could hear the kids talk about their experiences. The overwhelming results of the kids had a lot of fun, and I will present this data as soon as I can get it collated. The kids had a lot of fun with the computer. They said it's more fun to type than it is to handwrite. Most of them said they thought they could do better. By most, I'm saying 90%. I mean, it's the vast majority said I can do better typing than I can handwriting. Interestingly, the couple of classrooms I was in, the kids said, yes, we type all the time in class. And the teacher looked at me and said, I've never had them type in class. So we know we're getting eighth grade self-reports, so we don't know what we're really getting in some of these. But these little eight-year-olds are very cute. I got one little girl with her hand on her hip saying, Miss Perry, I have been typing since I was 4 years old. Like, that's half your life when you're 8 years old. That's a long time. So they seem to do fine. We are looking through again. We know we've got third graders who got the highest score possible on these essays. So we are going to be looking at the data as soon as we get that all in and cleaned and aggregated. But we did not get any calls from teachers saying, my kid just can't do it. They can't type. We learned some things that are going to help us with professional development. I think teachers say they needed practice typing a little bit more, practice using the tools. One big issue we saw in Southwest Kansas that had a high proportion of English language learners is the kids thought it was a typing test, so they typed exactly what they saw on the screen. So as opposed to understanding that this is a question you're supposed to answer, they would retype the passage and retype the question, which gets you a non-response. But That's a professional development. That's a teaching. We need to teach them what they're supposed to do here, because I'm sure they do typing in EL programs. I think that's about all I know about third grade at this point.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, and the other thing, it was interesting being in the schools and having lots of my staff in schools and graduate students in schools. The teachers, as much as anything, appreciated just having a chance to talk to us about what they thought about what was going on, which was sort of a side benefit, getting a lot of good feedback from teachers. So one thing we're absolutely going to do this year, and again, we need to get through the data analysis first to pick out the appropriate things to release, but we're going to release one of the MDPTs and one of the math performance tasks in each grade to make sure they have something to be practiced with. Because one of the teachers, or what several of the teachers were saying, is that once they can see what we've been doing, they think they can create their own tasks that are similar to have students practice with. So we're going to be working with that and putting that on Kite, because it's not just practicing. KSDE did a nice job putting out some practice MDPTs, but they practiced in the classroom handwriting. So now we need to get them to practice on Kite using the Kite tools to do these tasks. So we'll have that out for next fall so teachers could start practicing with that. So scoring, we've talked to you about this, that we set up a pilot distributed scoring process, which means that CETE never left our building. We worked with a subcontractor to use their platform to score remotely. What several of our districts did was set up a professional development day and devote it solely to scoring. So I think the Latha, Blue Valley, and Emporia all did that. So they just had hundreds of teachers online at the same time scoring in a central location for them, but not something where we came. They still took the training online. All the items appeared online, or all the responses appeared online for them to score. It was successful in the sense that the teachers, we also sent out a survey asking them about how this went. The teachers really appreciated the experience. We did hear a lot that they understand better how to teach having gone through this process. Now they really can tear apart the standards. They get the rubrics now. They said they next year they can improve their teaching process having gone through the scoring. And they liked seeing the range of responses randomly assigned. So they have no idea if the kid was from their district or not, but they got to see a range of responses from our students. So we had approximately 33 districts participate in scoring. And I said Olathe, Blue Valley, and Emporia had by far the most teachers. I think Olathe had over 700. So we got about 114,000 student responses scored, and approximately 2,640 teachers participated in scoring. But we have 260,000 kids in our state who each produce two things that need to be scored, a math performance task and an ELA performance task. So this pilot was a success in the sense that we got scores that we needed to do the analyses this year. We were able to pilot test the software. We were able to work with teachers to figure out what worked, what didn't work. It was a failure in the sense of asking for volunteers and hoping we could do this through a volunteer basis, because we need about 600,000 student responses scored next year. And so a volunteer scoring 114 is about 20% of what we need in operational year. So we've got some thinking to do to figure out how to do scoring at a reasonable cost in the future. So as I said, right now we're busy doing analyses. The very first thing we're working on is setting up the analyses to put together the packet of material to do standard setting. Standard setting is the process we use to set the cut scores. So we've had to set three cut scores on each of 14 assessments in the month of July. We will be convening educators the week of July 20th. Beth has been recruiting all of them from across our state to come in to Topeka for 4 days and set cut scores. July 30th, we'll have a policy committee review the cut scores. I'm going to come in next month with a full briefing on exactly how we do standard setting. I want you to be very familiar with the process before we come back and show you the results, because I want to make sure it's clear what we're going through, because it is a very scientific, rigorous process. It is very content-based. We bring in some data to help guide the understanding of the impact of the results. But what we are doing is bringing in educators, bringing in teachers with a strong content knowledge to say how much of our standards should kids know and be able to do before we're willing to call them a level 2 student, a level 3 student, and a level 4 student. So I will describe that July 14th at your next board meeting, get into those full details. August 11th, I'll be back to present our results. This will be after we have the standard setting the week of July 20th. July 30th, we bring in a policy committee. The policy committee looks a lot more at the impact. What does this actually mean for the students in our states? What percentage of them will be level 3 or higher? How does that vary across different student groups in our state? And they will make some final recommendations to KSDE. And then when we bring the results back on August 11th, that'll be KSDE's recommendation to you. And then the following month, September 8th, is when you'll decide about it. And at that point, if your decision is to approve, or if your decision is to adjust, either way, we'll be able to release reports very quickly. If you approve it, we'll release reports immediately. If you adjust, it'll probably take us a day to get the results released. But the results will be released immediately upon your approval in September. Which brings us to score reports. Yes, you got these passed out, it looks like. So what I want to talk to you about now is this packet that you've got in front of you, the orange. This is our attempt about being a sunflower state. We had a hard time doing a sunflower, so we decided we would do a sunrise. But these reports, my team took a first stab at designing them. And then this was something that, again, in the idea of efficiency, we wanted to get as close as possible, Kansas and Alaska agreeing on what score report should look like with some things that are customized for each state. Alaska's colors are the colors of icebergs, basically. We've got the sunrise here. But these have gone through focus groups. We've gone to our CAC. They've gone through focus groups with test coordinators, principals, teachers, parents in Kansas and Alaska, and bringing all the feedback and trying to say, okay, how do we make these better? How do we make these better? How do we make these better? And working with KSDE and then the Alaska Department of Education and Early Development. We call them EED. So whenever I say EED, I always mean the Alaska Department of Education. They just have a different name. And our two departments work together, and this is where we landed. So this one is the student report. This is what parents will receive. This will also be made available at the schools. But it'll show the very top large one is what the student did. Put you here. Is how the student scored, and then that will be compared to how did your school score overall, the district, and the state. We'll also have a couple of different codes on here. So the one I showed you here is exited. So if you look right next to where it says Adams test score, there's a little door with an arrow coming through it that says exited. This means that after or during the test window, Adam exited the test. We've got one that looks like a consumer report half filled in circle that says incomplete. That means that student did not complete all the parts. Remember I said there's four parts for each test. If they did not complete all the parts, we will still generate a score report, but we will make it clear that it was an incomplete test. The student did not take all four parts. The third rule we have is if, in this example here, we have 65 students in the school. And again, this would be 65 students in the school at that grade level, whatever Adam is a third grader. So this would be 65 students in third grade three. And this is, by the way, all made up. I realized this morning we probably should have put sample in here. Don't think you're looking at real scores. They're actually nonsensical if you try and look at them too hard. But if the school happens to have only six students in grade three, that school median bar will only show 1, 2, 3, 4. The arrow will disappear. The score and the standard error will disappear, and it'll say data suppressed to control for student privacy. So for student privacy reasons, we will not report scores less than 10. So at the first glance, it'll look similar, except you'll realize there's no arrow and no number on whatever it is that has fewer than 10 students. On the back, you'll see the subscores. Now, I showed you the back of, which one is this? The school report. Just so I could show you the four claims. In the student report, we are actually combining claims 2, 3, and 4 because we don't have enough items to produce a reliable result without the math performance task. And this year we are not giving the results of the math performance task because it was a pilot. Once we have the math performance task, we will have enough points we can give all the claims. But just on machine scorable, we really aren't getting into things like problem solving, communicating, reasoning, modeling, that really needs a student-generated response, not a multiple choice or drag and drop kind of thing. But those are the four claims that we built the whole test off of, and so these are the score reports that they will get. And then the one big difference for the school and the district reports is that we call these hanging bar charts or floating bar charts, but that broad line in the middle is our goal. We want to get our kids to level three. So this shows as a quick, hopefully eye-catching way to show what percentage of your kids are above that crucial bar and how that compares. In this case, this is a school report, how that compares to your district and your state. So one more piece, if you look at, school detail report versus school summary report. So that is, this and this. It's one of those things where you're like, you be careful what you ask for, because we went to the CAC and we said, we've got two options. We can give you a school detail report, which gives you all the information for one grade. So this is grade three, I believe. Yes, grade three mathematics. So this whole report is about grade three mathematics. Or we can give you one report that shows all the grades in your school. So this happens to be a 3 through 10 school, or probably a K-12 school, but we only test in grades 3 through 10. And then we can show everything together so you can look at your third graders compared to your fourth graders, et cetera. And show you both the median scores and the performance levels. And so we brought that to the CAC and said, which would you like? And of course, they said both. So we're doing both. So what you have in front of you is a school summary report and a school detail report. Districts will have the exact same thing. They'll get a district summary report and a district detail report. The only thing they won't have is the school data on it. So they'll have two meters. We are calling these our meters. And they will have two bars instead of three. But they'll get the exact same report. So that part was easy, at least. We could just copy what we did for schools. But they wanted both, so they'll get both. Yes, sir.
Kathy Bush has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On the back side, when you use the terminology claims, I've spent quite a few years in schools, and that threw me.
Yep.
So maybe asterisking it or somehow referring them to below.
Okay.
As far as, because I assume these are things that go to parents.
Yes, the student report goes to parents, not the other two, but
so
the one.
Somehow designating that they can go to below to see what a claim means.
Okay, that's a good idea. Yeah, I think it will throw parents off because our blueprints, everything that we've released to schools uses the word claims. We're hoping teachers, principals, et cetera, are more used to seeing it because everything preparing them for the assessment uses the word claims.
I think the parents, yeah.
Yeah, insurance. Honestly, it's something called evidence-centered design that we use now to design assessments. And what we're saying is tests allow us to make a claim about the student's ability. And what is the evidence we have to support a claim we're making about student's ability? So these actually are were generated with Smarter Balanced, and when we sat down and said, could we come up with anything better? We couldn't, so we decided to use it. But that's where it comes from. So yes, it's not meant to be insurance claims or. It's okay. I think that's my last slide. So any other questions, or I'll have a seat.
Sally Campbell.
You made a remark that went back to a something that just kind of goes up my back and comes back down.
I'm sorry.
I'm concerned about, you know, one thing we were really trying to get away from, at least I was, in developing of these tests, is the pressure the teachers feel about these tests.
Agreed.
And when you said when you visited with teachers, then they felt like they could, I felt like, learn to teach to the test again. I don't want that going on. I want them to teach the standards.
Absolutely.
So we know the assessment of the child. Is that fear and that, oh my God, these kids got to do this great on the test only going to go away with time in your point of view? Or is there something we could be doing to relieve this fear? Mm-hmm. Because when you look over the whole, of course, we haven't got through with our new accreditation, which I think that's going to help.
Yep.
But what can we do? Do you have any ideas or anything on how we can get rid of this fear of testing?
Mm-hmm. So a couple things. First of all, my bias, I'll admit, goes a long way back. My mother was a science and math teacher turned principal. And so everybody's been giving you quotes this morning. I'll give you one. Her quote to me was, build me a test I want to teach to, and I'll be happy to teach to the test. And I've been thinking that as my mantra my whole career. Because my goal is I don't want people teaching to the test. I want people teaching to the standards, and that just happens to mean they're teaching to the test, not the other way around. But sometimes I think we push things out the other way around, that they teach to the test, and by doing so, they end up teaching to the standards. I believe where I made the remark that gave you the willies was when I was talking about the scoring. And I think, you know, the state has a long history of writing tests and working with rubrics. And I think rubrics take time to pull apart and say, what am I really looking for? What is it that separates a score of two versus a score of three? And what are all these different features? And I think you just hand it to a teacher and say, teach it. she'll do her best more superficially to start with, but I think going through scoring allows them to really tease apart what they mean, and they were designed by our ELA and History, Government, Social Studies content leads at KSDE and CETE working together to say, how do we really take the standards and say, what are we looking for here? What are we valuing? And how do we spread out how well you're doing on these standards? So the rubrics themselves are truly written directly to the standards. And the feedback I was getting from teachers was really they understand the standards better by having gone through these rubrics, which helps them understand how to teach writing better based on our Kansas College and Career Ready standards. Okay.
Steve Roberts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your work. I want to share with you something I shared at the NASB conference in St. Louis. I went to a one-day conference, and we had a presentation from someone from Achieve who threw a lot of data at us, and I related a story from driving across Missouri. They have these public service messages, buckle up, be safe, all those sorts of things. And one had a statistic that said last year, I believe it was 278 people died on Missouri roads, 63% were not wearing a seatbelt. So I shared that with the folks at the conference in St. Louis. And I said, perhaps it's because I'm a math teacher, but that number really doesn't mean anything to me unless I know the other number. How many people buckle up?
Right.
Right? If 63% on average buckle up, then the statistic is really meaningless. You know, what do seatbelts do for us? Hopefully more than 63% of our population buckles up. Is there a way, and I understand that there are limitations on what we can publish and what parents can know and what they should know and so forth, but can we be more privy to the numbers behind the numbers? I mean, it's great to get, you know, we're above proficient or below proficient, but to simply publish that or to know it as a board member, it doesn't serve my purposes here as well as some other things might. So can we get, for want of a better phrase, the number of people who are actually buckling up? You see what I'm getting at?
You want the raw numbers of people who reached each of the...
But we have to coordinate this. I mean, in a sense, our standardized tests are telling us which kids have parents struggling with modern life.
Mm-hmm.
The ones who do poorly have parents who are struggling. That's what it tells us. So we have to coordinate with that data. Otherwise, we just have data.
So tell me specifically what it is you're looking for. I guess that's where I'm not clear.
Well, if I knew, then I'd go get it. So we'll have to talk. We'll have to flesh this out. I think it's a process, actually.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely giving numbers, if that's what you're looking for, is easy. What's not easy is giving you percent correct, because when we move adaptive, percent correct becomes meaningless.
This is somehow related to the multiple measures, and I'm not clever enough to tell you what data I'm looking for, but
okay.
I'm sure we'll be talking. Thank you.
And the other thing that's probably worth talking about at a future board meeting is our work in building up an interim assessment system and formative tools to use in a classroom. So I'll put that on a future agenda to talk to you too, because we really are trying to create a comprehensive assessment system that's fully aligned within Kansas that builds on each other. So teachers have tools to use during the school year that will also help them prepare their kids or know how well their kids are doing in terms of learning the standards. Again, understanding that if they really show that they're learning their standards through the school year, then they ought to be just fine on the summative assessment.
Kathy Bush.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On the MDPT, I still got to get those
that
acronym in my brain. This is the piece that is scored. It's a piece of reading, and then the kids do a written response to that piece of reading.
Correct.
And the piece of reading has a tendency to either be social studies based or science based. Is that?
Or there could be ELA literature, real literature.
But the rubric that is used, because, you know, in the past we spent lots of time with the six traits.
Yes.
So what is this? What kind of rubric are we using? Where are we with this?
So we actually have three rubrics because kids could give a narrative response. They could give an expository response or... They don't use the word persuasive anymore, but that's how I think about it. The persuasive, argumentative, there we go, argumentative.
Okay.
So we have three rubrics, one for each kind of writing. Can't come up with the four dimensions. There are four dimensions that they're scored on. One is about, can you state a claim? Can you show relevant evidence? Structure, I believe, and then I believe the last is conventions. So are you writing appropriately, grammatically correct? And one of the things about looking at it from the four dimensions is it allows history, government, and ELA to focus on or to weight the dimensions differently. So social studies can say, I care a lot less about if they got the comma in the right place than I do about were they able to give a coherent analysis of this particular bill and the Bill of Rights. So we do have, they're all online on KSDE.org. I should have brought a copy of those, I forgot. But they have been online, I believe, since about January for teachers to use and to be familiar with. And so those are readily available. Math rubrics are very item specific.
Right.
So we don't have those available for teachers. But that is one of the things we are doing with the scoring results is refining those rubrics, because we did see some things where we need to be a little more crisp about how we distinguish between one score point and another. And these are all 4 points. If you figure 4 dimensions by 4 points is how students get scored.
So are the schools giving feedback that they appreciate the rubrics, that they're helpful for them? Maybe heard any of that? I don't know if that's you to answer that question or.
Yeah, that would be Susie. So I don't know if you guys have heard anything.
I think so far they have done exactly that. We
okay.
mentioned that in your scoring process. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we heard from the teachers who did scoring, but I haven't heard from all the teachers across the state.
We had to add extra sessions to the scoring. Susie Ortel, our writing consultant here, has been doing, I think, for three months now. So it is a switch, as you said, from the mm-hmm. 6-trait model that we've had in the past for a couple of reasons. We in the past sort of arbitrarily decided, it's maybe too strong a word, that if you were in elementary, you should write narrative. If you were in middle school, you should write expository and then persuasive at high school. That was difficult to defend sometimes. For example, one of the hardest things to do is to tell a story with dialogue and all of that. Well, we assign that to the youngest grade levels, elementary. Lots of folks were saying, well, they should have probably been assigned expository. But anyway, that was in the old model. So there is PD, professional development, that we're going to continue to be working on with these rules. Okay.
Thank you.
Well, before you sit down and we move on, a year ago, we were looking pretty bleak. You know, and I just want to remember that for a moment because this is such a 180 turnaround. Congratulations to you and your staff. But and as well as, I think we need to send a special thanks to all our teachers, assessment leaders, scorers, the thousands of professionals in our state who made this work.
Absolutely.
It's one thing, yes, don't teach the test, you know, teach the standards. They have to do that, but they also have the administrative functions and the commitment to make sure that this system worked. And as a state board, we are deeply appreciative of the teachers, the assessment leaders, the scorers, and all the people who helped administer these assessments in the schools to make it successful.
Thank you. If you'll allow me just 1 minute of a personal statement, I want to echo that. I also want to throw back thank you to both KSDE and the State Board. The ironic thing is I am now a national expert on technology glitches in educational testing. That
Congratulations.
So I've been on the phone with Minnesota, with Nevada, with Florida, a lot of the states that went through the problems this year. And the biggest message I keep giving them, because they said, you know, we're getting so much flack from our teachers, I said, you have to be transparent. You have to tell them what's going on, what you're doing about it, what you're going to do with releasing results. Be transparent. This state, because of the leadership in this room, allowed us to be transparent, and that's how we pulled through this. And there are states that are not doing that are in a world of hurt right now. So I think you should all understand how much that work went to helping everything work forward. Is we were honest with our teachers, we were honest with our testing coordinators, we were honest with our superintendents and our parents, and I think they respect us because of that. So thank you for the leadership as well.
Thank you.
I'm going to invite Beth to start without me here as I get her slide up and running.
Best news I have to bring to you today. Is that I don't have anything new to share, really, because we've been so in touch with CETE that one of the things we wanted to do was make the opportunity available for people to give us feedback so that we could identify problems and know what we needed to work on. And really, is anything new, because we've been working with CETE on all these problems all the way through. So I think that's a good thing that we've been able to identify them. A lot of the fixes are already in place. We just did a casual survey. I started at the curriculum leaders. I said, here's the website. You can give me your comments. And then we sent out on the listserv a couple times, and we had over 500 responses. It was phenomenal. The people that wanted to share their opinions about the test. 170 different districts responded, 22 different groups of people. So out of the 500 responses, over 200 of them were from teachers that took the time to go in and share with us. This is what we captured electronically. My assistant Juanita Anderson did most of the work on this project. But then the content people at KSDE got emails from teachers all the way through. Lee Jones, our test coordinator, received a lot of comments. I know the commissioner, Scott, we all received a lot of other comments that we tried to feed into this too, but by and large, we all heard the same thing. So the first thing I asked was, what were your technology issues? And overwhelmingly, everyone answered that. Oh, so much better than last year. Thank you for fixing all the problems. But we know there's some issues that came up, things that Dr. Perry's talked about before. And what was interesting, at least, and from my personal observation, I would go into one building and the Chromebooks would work fine. Another building, there were some issues. CETE technology was all over it. They worked very closely with the schools. The multiple answers, you've already heard about that, drag and drop issues. There was some concern about the autosave on the performance tasks. We let everyone know it wasn't there, but you know how it is when you're working with something. We all do that every day in our own life, and we forget to save, and it's gone. So we're aware of that issue, too. Sometimes, locally, there were some connection issues. And if the schools weren't caching, you know, they could have lost some student responses. And then it's always interesting when you talk about, and you'll notice in a couple of my other slides that people talk about, when you're actually giving information from the computer voice and the teacher is not actually reading to you. Some thought the reader was too fast. Some thought it was too slow. Some speed issues. It'll just take a little while to look on it. And then I think maybe at some point early on there were some font size problems. The next thing we asked about was the test administration. And we know there were a lot of tickets this year. Sections, parts, tickets, everyone, it was a new thing they had to learn how to maneuver. We're working on it. CAC spent about an hour working with CETE last week on what some solutions to this problem would be. Again, the autosave on the MDPTs. Another issue that came up that we're aware of is that the directions in the manual weren't always grade appropriate. So probably for the younger kids were we didn't really look at how they were written closely enough. We need to work on that and make sure the directions are really grade appropriate. Another thing is the estimate of testing times was not accurate. And we shared our expectations, and we know that the testing time ended up being a lot shorter. That's good news. But for schools that had planned on what we had suggested, they felt like they were spending a lot of time in the computer lab that maybe wasn't necessary because we hadn't really done our part, but it was our first time through. We didn't really know. We were giving our best estimates. Next year, we'll be able to do a much better job. And then there was also a comment on, again, it's probably from veteran teachers that have done it before, how they monitored students in the old system, how they're monitoring students in the new system, how they know when the test is complete and when it isn't, when they have to go back and have students do another part. We're working with them to fix some of those issues in Kite. So I'm not doing very good with assigning to this one. Content. So I asked a question, what did you think of the content of the test? The overwhelming response was that the students reacted very favorably to the new format of the items. They really liked the technology enhanced, and we got a lot of comments on the MDBT that they enjoyed the writing. That it was fun, it was different, it was something they hadn't done. Very positive. Probably the single largest complaint we received this year about the content of the test was that there were some off-grade level items included in the field test section. If you remember, when we've explained to you in the past that the test had the 25-item part to start with, and then there were three 15-item sections. And one of those sections every year will be devoted to field testing new items. So we can release items every year. We can replace, build our test bank. There are a lot of reasons to have a field test block. But within the field test block, there were some off-grade level items. And to our teachers' credit, they were so familiar with the standards that they were able to tell us that that standard really wasn't grade appropriate that was being tested. So I don't know how you interpret that. I mean, I think that's a good thing. I mean, and then from the test security side, you know, that first email that came in and we're going like, you're not supposed to be reading those items on the screen. So we had to work through that too. But that was probably, that was unexpected. We didn't do a very good job of preparing the field that they might see some items like that. So it was a field test year. It's a field test section. And with the performance tasks, there was a wide range of those also. So some students may have received a performance test that they thought was more difficult than maybe the student sitting next to them just because of the way it was rotated. In the future, all the students will be doing the same performance task every year. Another manual issue about not really having like some standard responses to questions that could be anticipated for teachers to respond to. So, and then again with the format of the test, consolidating sections, parts, we're aware of those issues. And then the last one I asked about was the accommodations. This is always, again, the most interesting. They thought the computer voice was awesome compared to the one we had a long time ago, which was David. I think it's incredible. They liked that it paced the assessment. If you look down at the issues, then they didn't think they liked the voice. They wanted a human reader, and the person talked too fast. So I mean, that's just something we have to work through. We probably aren't going to please everyone all the time on that issue. And I thought this was a great statement, too, that the assessment allowed our students the opportunity to show what they've learned. And ultimately, that's really what we want out of the assessment, and that was very good. So what are we doing then? The next steps, we're working with CETE to talk about the technology issues. Most of them have been fixed already. We've had discussions about the test length and the number of tickets. We're working on manual revisions over the summer. And of course, we know that the 2016 assessment will be adaptive. And that should address a lot of the issues where people felt like they were getting more difficult items than maybe they should have. So when it goes adaptive, we think that will take care of a lot of the difficulty concerns that we heard expressed. And right now, at least the tentative, we haven't made a firm decision, but I wanted to share this with you. We've also talked about one in light of the scoring needs that we're going to have. And then with the activities, we're going to probably do two windows next year. We'll do a performance task window that we'll have first. It'll be in February. Open the machine scored window. And since CETE was able to track, monitor the traffic, we really feel like that the length of those windows will accommodate everyone's needs, will help us with the scoring issue. And ultimately our goal, if we're successful with this, would be to get the results out to the schools by the end of the school year or in early June so they can get them back to parents and it will be more timely information.
Questions? Well, again, thank you for your work. It's great to see us getting that feedback from the field. That's probably what's going to sustain us as we move forward. Scott, anything else?
Sleep.
Better watch this group.
Sleep.
Might leave on you.
No, I think I'm going to put words in Marianne's mouth. The next presentation, you will be here. Just wanted to reiterate, she will be here in July to walk this board through some of the information that you'll be getting in advance of the decision that has to be made down the road. So I think just to remind folks that we will be here again, she will be here again in July, because we don't set cut scores every year. This is a large and sophisticated undertaking. So we're going to need help and communicate. We'll do our best to communicate all of those points. That's it.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. Safe travels to Alaska and back. At this particular point, we'll break for lunch and return at 1:30. Thank you very much.